kale, mustard, turnip, you know, get all those other kinds of vegetables. You'll have to have the same, you'll have to like it. Where I live, we have a food service committee, or whatever, a meeting from time to time, and we can voice our opinion about food or whatever. And so I told the chef, I said, I want some okra. And I said, I don't know if anybody else in there likes okra or not, but I do. And so, you know, some people say, you know, it's slimy. And, well, whether it's slimy or whether it's whatever it is, I like okra. And so he was okay, he wrote it down, you know. But, pardon me? Oh, okay. Yeah, I like it in soup. I like it, whatever. I just like okra. I prefer, you know, some people say, well, I can eat it if it's fried. I don't prefer it fried, but that's just me. But I don't, you don't have to like what I like. You know, everybody knows one of the things I like is watermelon. Well, you don't have to like watermelon. I mean, don't. I mean, nobody's, you know, you're not going to have a quicker or a faster, or, you know what I mean? There's nothing, there's no advantage to you, everybody liking the same thing. So what I'm getting at, with God's drama production, He made us all different. And so, since He made us all different, we're supposed to produce those different qualities that He gave to us.
Amen.
Even in ministry, there's some people say, well, I don't like this, and I don't like that, and I don't like the other. Well, chances are, what you like is somewhere. So you just keep coming, you'll get it after a while. Just keep sticking, you know, in other words, it's not a matter of, I don't want to be a Christian because I don't like the way, you know, Velma preaches or Grace or whatever preaches. You'll find somebody that preaches according to something that you can assimilate. Mm-hmm. But if it's the word of God, you should like that. You may not like the delivery style, but you should like the word.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes, if I turn my TV on for a program, there may be people on there that I don't prefer their style of preaching. But I make myself listen if I think that they are, you know, have something that's valuable to me. It doesn't matter how they, you know, their mannerisms, that doesn't matter. I can overlook that, because I want what they have from the Lord. Mm-hmm. If I feel like they're an anointed person, you know, then I just overlook all that other stuff and just go with the flow. So God's drama production is very important. What I'm getting at, I guess, is, well, not I guess, I'm getting at, is the fact is everybody is important in God's production. Everybody. There's no unimportant people. I don't care what it is that God has given you to do. It's not unimportant.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Nothing
Thank
unimportant.
You.
Sunday when she said thank you, Jesus, it made me think of something. When we had Sunday morning, we had testimonies. I've been having testimonies because that gives people an opportunity. Because we used to have testimonies at St. Service. We tried to have a space where I asked the praise leader to give a chance for two or three at the most testimonies because our time is limited, and I don't want people to just stand up saying I thank God for being saved all day, and you know, we want real testimonies what God has done for them. But anyhow. Here's what I was going to say. I forget who testified on Sunday, but we had two. But one, I know, was my daughter. And what she said was three or four words. She said it three times. And I was saying to myself, now I'm just going to tell you the way I was thinking. I was thinking, well, you know, I didn't quite hear the testimony part. That's what I'm thinking. But she just said what she said. She didn't take up a lot of time. Just said it for that. But someone that evening told me what she said was directly to them. I said, really? Said it struck them to the heart. And said, I knew that was an answer for me. I said, well, Lord, I just give you praise. It was like a prophetic utterance, but it wasn't. It wasn't like a testimony. But it was what God wanted to say. So she said it, and it was, and when that person said it, they were so blessed by those about three words. I don't anybody remember.
She said we're supposed to save souls.
Save souls.
Where are the souls that you promised me? Where are the souls?
Where are the souls that you promised me? Mm-hmm. And that was what was in the heart of somebody. And that struck that man, and he was just totally blown out of the water because of those words that she said. She said it three times. So what I'm getting at is everybody is not alike. I'm trying to get that across. So you don't get uptight because folks don't do stuff like you think they ought to do them, unless they are totally out of order. And sometimes people are out of order and you have to shut them down. That's just a fact for people out of order. But unless a person is really out of order, if they're doing what God said to, you have to have your heart open and your ears open to receive and not be so critical of what is going on. You know, some of us are just like mice waiting for the cheese. You know, just, oh, here's a piece. Yeah, I mean, we just waiting on somebody to criticize. We're just waiting, just like baits out there, and you just can't hardly wait to snap that bait up. Mm-hmm. And let me tell you, anybody ever read John Bevere's book, The Bait of Satan? The Bait of Satan.
Sorry,
by John Bevere.
Bevere.
Bevere. B-E-V-E-R-E. But anyway, he's a prolific writer. Very good, very spiritual minister. But anyhow, he wrote a book about the bait of Satan. And Satan has bait out there so you can snatch it up, so you can get out of the will of God. And that's what he would like very much, for you to get out of God's will. And when you get out of God's will, then you lose your purpose because you're looking at somebody else's purpose and trying to judge them, whether they're right or wrong. You're not the judge. Sorry. You're not the judge. All right. So we're going to read a portion of Romans 12, and then we're going to go back to the second scripture that we had last week, the church, God's drama production. All right. Who wants to read that can read pretty swiftly? The 12th chapter, let's read it down. Six verses. Anybody want to read? Romans 12. Mm-hmm.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, and be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. For I say through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, But you think soberly, according to a God who dealt with every man in many of those faith. Whereas we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office. So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one member one of another, having then gifts differently according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the portion of faith. Did you want to go past it?
Well, maybe so, maybe so.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Or ministry, let us wait on our ministry. Or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exalted on exaltation. He that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth with diligence. He that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without dissimulation. Apart that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. Be kindly, affectionate one to another, with brotherly love and honor, preferring one another, not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instantly in prayer. And go farther.
Might as well finish it.
The necessity of the saints given to hospitality. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but conceding to man of low esteem. Be not wise in your own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Prove things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lie in you, live peaceably with all men. Give your love, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt keep cold the fire on his head. Be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good.
Okay. Thank you so much. You know, the whole chapter. If we could do this chapter, this, can you see that this is the church, God's drama production? Can you see this is his production? This is what he has envisioned for his church and his building. He says, the first verse, he says, I'm really pleading with you. I'm begging you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. The Lord told me some time ago, he said, I'm not looking for martyrs, I'm looking for praisers and worshipers. In other words, when we present our body, we are to be a sacrifice to God, holy and acceptable unto him. That's just our reasonable service. However, he's not looking for us to just lay down our lives to be so we can die. I mean, he doesn't need dead people. You know, David said the dead can't praise him. He needs somebody that's going to live it. In other words, if you go through something, you know, have you ever gone through something and you just feel like, well, I might as well give up and die? I remember years ago, this is a whole bunch of years ago, I was going through some stuff and it seemed like so many people were against me. I figured, well, Lord, if you just take me on out of the world, I know I'm going to heaven. So then they'll be happy. Just let me go. And then everybody will be happy. That's just the way I felt, you know. But God is not interested in that. And that was just kind of selfish. Whole lot selfish. Okay. That's what it was. Because I wanted to get out of my misery God said, I want you to go through so you can be of service to me. So are you willing to go through, or do you want to give up? Which one do you want to do? I didn't really want to die, but I wanted to die. I wanted to go through. As a matter of fact, I told this story so many times. As a matter of fact, I told the Lord, I got out on my knees one time. I came to church, got on my knees, and I said, it wasn't even in this church. But anyhow, I got on my knees and I said, Lord, now you know what to do. All you have to do is just take my breath. I'm ready to go. So you just take me. I'm here. And I stayed there on my knees. I stayed there, and waited for God to take my breath. Until I got embarrassed. And as you know, he didn't take it, so I finally got up, determined to fight a faith. But you know, sometimes things just, and see, it's the enemy that does that. He wants to put it in your mind that, you know, you don't have no friends, nobody loves you, nobody's concerned about you, so if you just get out of the way, then they can be happy and go on with their life. Mm-hmm. But God said, I'm not interested in a martyr. I'm interested in someone to give me glory and to give me praise. And you've got to go through something to be able to give him praise, because then you can praise him for what you've gone through. I've got so many things that I can give him praise for, because I've gone through so many things. And I can help so many people. If you haven't gone through anything, you can't help folks, you know, because, you know, you can just tell them, oh, well, you know, you can give people a lot of what you call glib-ish remarks about what they're going through. Oh, you can take that. Oh, that's just good. Oh, come on. Yeah. Like what they're going through is not there anymore. But when you've gone through it yourself, then you know, yeah, they're for real. They're hurting. You know, and sometimes people are really, really hurting. And you don't know how bad they're hurting unless you have experienced, you don't have to experience everything. I can't, you know, nobody can experience everything that everybody has experienced, but you can experience like stuff, similar stuff. And so you know how that person is hurting on the inside, and you can have maybe not sympathy, but you can have empathy for them and pray for them and go alongside of them to help them through whatever they're going through. So anyhow, this is what he's wanting. He wants you to be a living sacrifice. Now, he hasn't left dead sacrifices. All them animals and things. But those were dead sacrifices. He said, I want a living sacrifice. I want somebody who's going to sacrifice this life that says, you know, we used to sing a song. I don't know whether the young people remember the song or not. But the song says, I'm going through, I'll pay the price, whatever others do. I'll take the way for the Lord's despised few. I started with Jesus, and I'm going through. Yeah. I'm going through. So you've got to make up your mind that I'm going through. Whatever the cost is, I'm going through. You don't know what the cost is going to be, but whatever it is, I'm going through. I went somewhere, was going to buy something, and the person said, as a matter of fact, the restaurant said, well, you can have so and so and so and so, and if you have this, it'll cost a little more, you know. I don't know what it was, but it'll cost more. I said, well, that's what I want. Well, are you sure that's going to be so and so? And I'm thinking, you don't know how much money I got. And I look like I'm rich, but I can pay for this meal. You know, I want, so this is what I want. I don't want, but so I want this. I know what I want. You know what? In other words, I'm willing to pay the price because I know what I want. If you know where you're going, and if you know what Jesus wants from you, and if you know, if you can see the end of your valley, if you can God is how you see the end, and you know you're going to get over that mountain, then you're willing to pay the price. Whatever the price is, it's worth it. So he said, now, I want you to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. And he says, this is true worship. You're making a sacrifice to live for God is true worship. You think you're only worshiping when you're singing and clapping and praising God like that. That's worship, but that's not a true worship. What he wants is the lifestyle, the whole life that you live, every day, every hour. That's true worship. And then he says, above all, don't copy the behaviors of the world. The world tries to give back what they think is being given to them. In other words, if you act ugly with them, then they act back ugly with you to get even with you. That's the worldly way of doing things. But when you do that, you're on the same par with them. In other words, that's low life. So if they're going to act low life, you're going to say, well, if you're going to do that, well, I'm just going to do it. Well, you're just as bad as they are. So you got to learn how to take low. When others are going high, you get low. All right. So the cornerstone of this production, I said, is, and that this is, we read the whole scripture. This is the cornerstone, in other words, the thing that holds the production together. You know, we have the Easter productions and Christmas productions in drama, in our drama department here at the church. But there's something, usually have a subject or a theme that holds the whole thing together. So the thing that holds God's production together is Jesus. He holds the whole thing. And if you get him in on this production, you've got it made. Because the sacrifice, and sometimes we don't understand, we think we're making a sacrifice for the preacher, or for, I'm doing it for my church. No, what you're doing it for God. You're not doing it for your church. It may profit your church. But what you do, and that's where people get it twisted, they think what they do, they're doing it either for the preacher or for, you know, somebody. But you do what you're doing for God because you're the one who'll get the blessing. I mean, what you do for God, he's not going to give me the blessing. You're going to get the blessing. And what I do for God, you may reap some of the benefits, but you're not going to get my blessing. Well, I'm getting my own blessing. And I'm taking every bit of it. And I trust you're going to get yours, too. All right. He said that. So don't copy the behaviors of the world, but let God transform you. All right, now we're getting back to the scriptures that we had last week. We only got to one. Let's read St. John 15, 16, and Ephesians 1 through 6. Everybody got a hand up? If you weren't here last week, you may not have one.
I made some new ones.
I have.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Sister, okay. Yes, she's right there. Oh. Anybody else?
Anybody else? Look at
this. Right there. Oops. Okay. Hello there. read the next two scriptures.
John 15:16.
Yes.
You did not choose me, but I chose you.
All right.
And appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain. That whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give.
You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I chose you so that you could be in this drama production and bear fruit. I want you to be somebody that I have chosen you to be. You can't play nobody else's part. Only your part. And that's why it's good not to try to be somebody else. You can be the best you that you could be. And you are the best you that ever lived. There won't be another you like you. There'll never be another you. You might have a kid, say, well, that kid's the spirit of you, but he's not going to be just like you. He's not going to have all the talents that you have. He may have some of them, but there's something about them different. You know, we say sometimes about people that marry. People usually marry opposites, because if you have someone just like you, the other one is not necessary. That's right. You want somebody just like you? No. You don't want somebody just like you. If they're just like you, now they may have some things that you both are compatible with, but you don't want somebody just like you. You know, and women, men do the same thing sometimes. Women try to turn men into women. I mean, they don't really need to be doing that, but they want them to be like them, think like them. You can't think like a woman and you're a man. And neither can a man think like a woman. I mean, neither can a woman think like a man. You can't think that way. You know, I tell this story over and over because it just, to me, it makes so much sense. When my youngest child, which Joe was 6 years old, we lived up on 16th Street, and there was a grocery right across Ainsworth, right a block down, I saw. And so he was six, and he wanted to go to the grocery. I said, oh, no, baby, you can't go to the grocery, you know, because, I'm thinking, might be getting my coming up. And believe you me, that was almost 50 years ago. That was 50 years ago. There weren't hardly any cars going up down this way. Well, no cars going up down this way. It was a street, but every once in a while there'd be a car. But I'm all scared, and so Bishop heard me talking with Joe, you know, telling him he couldn't go. And he said, I didn't want to go to the street. I said, okay. But he was, it was just fine. He could go to the grocery. He was just a block away, come back. He knew how to look both ways and come across the street. He was fine. But my point is, I'm a woman. And I'm trying to protect my baby. You understand what I'm saying? So a man's projection and his thoughts were totally different than mine. Because a man is adventurous, and they want to get out there and do stuff, you know. And I want to, you know, hold them inside. But that was one of the first things I learned about men and women. Not that was the only thing I learned, but I mean, that was the point. To me, that was very, very visual. I learned that I can't, and I didn't try to make him think, like, I didn't argue with him, you know. So, Dad said, you can go, you can go, you know. But I'm just thinking, I thought about that so many times after that. You know, if things had gone like I wanted to go, he would have been a little sissy. Right. I mean, I've just been protecting him like this little baby, you know. I mean, a kid 6 years old can go to school by itself. So, what can I say? You just can't make a man think like a woman. And that's why a man is there and a woman is there, because God put a different brain into the woman that he put into the man. And a woman is made for nurturing. So when it comes time for nurturing, now here's what happened. Another instance that was in our family. Bishop was really strong on making sure the kids learned how to work. And so he would have them working past lunchtime. I mean, if they didn't finish the work, it wasn't no lunch. Well, I said, well, not that good. No, that can't be. And so I got him wherever we talked. And I said, no, these kids got to have lunch. You know, I laid it all down there. I said, they got to have some lunch. You know, you can't work them all day because they haven't finished it. They can't have lunch. And, you know, I talked to him, and he listened. And so what I'm saying is, that was my nurturing part. You understand? So I played my part, and he played his part. And so that made the whole. That's why kids need a mother and a father. And they don't need to be fighting one against the other. And I just praise God for them. I had a husband that we never fought publicly in front of the kids. When I say fought, I mean, you know, discuss whatever was discussing. And we'd go in the corner or somewhere, or in the bedroom or wherever, somewhere, and talk about what the differences that we had about how we were raising the kids. But my thing is, when people get married sometimes, the wife wants the husband to think like he thinks, and the husband wants the wife to think like he thinks, and they're both wrong. You got to put the two together and let the wife do the nurturing and let the husband do the whatever. What do you call it? That ball to help me out here. What you say?
She's moving because I got her helping me at home, because she doesn't understand the fundamentals of tools, knowing where you are, because it's not been her experience. Sometimes it gets a little exciting, you know. We experienced it today through prayer. We got to know it.
And you told me you were sorry, right?
Sure I did. A lot of times today.
Yeah, well, you know, you can't expect a woman to be a carpenter when she's been a cook all her life.
Amen.
So you might have to carpenter by yourself.
Well, another test.
You may have to carpenter by yourself. All right, so much for that. But we're talking about the things that the way God has made us. We don't want to change people. The only way you want to change a person is for them to be more like Christ. Like Christ. That's all. Excuse me. So he said, and don't think you are better than you really are. Your way of doing things is not the perfect way of doing it. There may be another way. In other words, I may mop the floor this way and you may mop it that way. But don't tell me I'm not mopping it. You know what I'm saying? But some people think if you don't mop it this way, it's not mop. Just wait and see if it's clean or not. That's all you have to do. Don't tell me how I got to mop it. I'm going to have to mop it like you mop it. This is the way you're supposed to do it. No, not necessarily. All I'm supposed to do is get it clean. I'm preaching good now. I'm preaching good. But because many of our problems come from us trying to make the other person be like us. I mean, a woman is not supposed to be like a man. That's why I guess these men were married men, I don't know. If they're looking for somebody like them. You want a man, I mean, you know. So much for that. And a woman. Well, you don't let that alone. But the thing is, God made us different. And he made us different for a purpose. And all the attributes that he gave each one are the attributes that he wants us to have.
Amen.
And depending on how you've been raised as to what, which one of those attributes you produce or exhibit, sometimes you've been raised, if you've been raised like a man, maybe you are a racehorse, you know. I mean, not a racehorse, but I mean, you've been raised like a workhorse. Maybe that's what you, that's all you know. But that may not be what you're supposed to be. All right. Don't think you're better than you really are. In other words, don't think your way is the only way. There is another way of getting it done. There's another way of getting it done. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves. Measure yourselves by the faith God has given you. Now let's read the next scripture. Ephesians 1, 3-6.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he has made us accepted in the beloved.
Now he made you accepted in the beloved when he adopted you. So you don't have to change anything other than, the songwriter said, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus on earth, I long to be like him all through life's journey from earth to the Lord. I only ask just to be like him. That's all you have to worry about. Be like him. Be like Jesus in the way in which he has made you.
Thank you, Father.
That is, you do your production with love.
Hallelujah.
That's all. Whatever you produce, do it with love.
Hallelujah.
Having adopted you, read this, that verse again.
Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ himself.
He predestined you before the foundation of the world. He wrote your script.
Hallelujah.
In other words, whatever you're supposed to do in life, whatever you're supposed to be, your script has already been written. And all you have to do is read the script and follow the script. That's all you have to do. Just read the script. What am I supposed to do today? Read the script. What am I supposed to do tomorrow? Read the script. And what is the script? The script really is the Word of God. If you want to know what you're supposed to do, read the Word, and God's Word will speak to you.
Amen. Hallelujah.
It doesn't matter. Say, well, where am I supposed to start reading? Just start. Just start.
Hallelujah.
And the Word of God will speak to you.
Hallelujah.
Everything that is said may not have been to you, but God will highlight what he wants you to know.
Hallelujah.
He'll highlight it.
Thank you, Father.
Say, well, how is he going to do that? Just read it. You'll see.
He's good.
I dare you to read it.
God
I
is
dare
good.
You to read it. I'll say, well, I read a scripture. No, I'm not talking about a verse. You read them, a couple, three or four chapters. It's surprising people that don't read the script.
Huh.
You want somebody to tell you what you're supposed to do in circumstances, and you haven't read your Bible in a week. That's nonsense. Normally we try to counsel you and talk to you if you haven't read your Bible. You got to read your word. That's why God left the word here for you to read. And then when he speaks to you, you need to write down what he says. Somebody said, well, I don't believe in writing that. Well, listen, then you don't believe in the word.
Because it's written
down. Because the apostles wrote everything he said to them.
I know, huh?
That's the only way you got the word.
Jesus.
So if you write what he says to you, you'll have word to you.
Yes, yes. This is good teaching, Pastor. Good teaching. Hallelujah.
Yeah, it's interesting how we don't understand. You know, we come out once a week or twice. Well, I can't say about you because you're here on Wednesday night. So you definitely are here more than once a week.
Hallelujah.
But the point is, are you going to just eat your breakfast today? And you're not going to eat more than Sunday?
That's
how many plan on not eating no more till Sunday? I think you're planning on eating before Sunday. I think you are. Some of you might be going to eat tonight. So, just like you eat the natural food tonight, before you go to bed, eat some spiritual food. Say, well, I've just been to the Bible study, that's good. But eat again. Just nibble. Eat the word. And you'll see your life will go a whole lot better. You're having problems that you don't know how to solve. Eat the word. You know, we have our classes now on Sundays at 11:30 and 12:30 and whatever. And the food class is very interesting because so many of us as Christians are sick, are afflicted in one way or the other. But we're learning how some of this, I don't really do because I do a lot of reading on food, but it doesn't matter. But we're learning how foods affect our life. And they affect what you have been doing all of your life up to this period of time. And if you don't change the way you eat, you're going to end up with a disease or sick. And you want to know, why did you get sick? And it's because of the way you were eating. And it's the same thing with the Word of God. Spiritually, you're going to be sick because of the way you've been eating. You've been eating erratically or erratically or not at all. And so, that's it. You know, a couple of years ago, I've given this testimony before. Went to the doctor for whatever, check up, and they told me my kidneys were failing. And I said, what? And that was so strange to me, you know. And we just watch it, you know. And so I went back later, and he showed me the graph, you know, and come down, you know, failing here. I said, and so I went to the Lord. The Lord said, read the word and drink water. That's what the Lord told me to do. Things have been on upgrade ever since. Read the word and drink water. And God said, I'll bless your bread and your water. So I told the Lord, he blesses water. But you see, sometimes we don't drink enough water. Naturally so. And so you dehydrate yourself so toxins can't go out of your body so the kidneys don't work right.
Amen.
So you've got to drink plenty of water. Naturally so. So, you know, I'm talking in the natural, but it also goes for the spiritual. It's the same thing. This is the water of life. And if you don't drink this water, you're going to thirst. And your kidneys are going to fail. In other words, all the toxins that are in your body, I'm talking spiritually now, the toxins that are in your body are going to surface up. You're going to be mad. You're going to be fussing. You're going to be ready to fight. You're going to be in all kinds of problems in your home because toxins are in your bloodstream spiritually because you have not drank the water of life. Well, if you start drinking this water, I dare you.
Yes.
I double dare you. I double dare you. Drink this water, honey, and the toxins will be flushed out of your. You can't drink this water more than noon at night. You know what I'm saying? And the toxins not go out of your system.
Hallelujah. Come on now.
You can't stay mad and drink this. You can't do it. It's impossible.
That's so cool.
You're going to get yourself right with God. And the more you read it, the more right you're going to get. If your family is not doing right, quit talking to the family and talk to the toxins.
Awesome, awesome,
you want
awesome.
Folks to do right, and you're not doing right.
Jesus.
Do what God told you to do.
Jesus.
Oh my God.
Another voice.
Do what God told you to do, and the family will come together.
Holy Ghost, talk to me. Holla about
you. We have families that are just
come on.
Everybody's doing their own thing because nobody is reading this word and getting the toxins out of their body.
Holla about some.
Everybody needs to read this word.
Glory to
not just the man of the family.
Thank you, Father.
The children need to read the word.
Thank you, Father.
The mother need to read the word.
Thank you, Father.
I said children, didn't I? Man, everybody. Uncles, aunts, everybody needs to read the word.
Thank
everybody needs to read the word.
Amen.
I had a beautiful upbringing, but my point is this. I didn't have a perfect family, but I know one thing. Every morning, there was some word read in my house.
Hallelujah.
Not my house. Our house. I mean, when I was a kid. The word was read. Daddy got this Bible, and we had to read. And I'm not talking about go to the table and say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want before I eat. No, no, no. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the word was read.
Thank you, Father.
My daddy read the word.
Thank you, Father.
He didn't wait for mama to read it. He read the word. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
They started off in the morning. I'd see them or hear them praying together. Then they'd read the word, and then they come down for breakfast, and Daddy would get us all around the table and read the word. And then we would pray.
Yes.
I don't mean we said, Lord, bless this food, sanctify Jesus. No, pray. We got out on our knees before breakfast. Now, the oatmeal, whatever was there, would have to get cold or hot or whatever. I don't remember that part. All I remember was every morning
when we was home. Thank you, Father.
At breakfast time, we'd get at the table.
Oh, no,
Daddy would read the scripture, and we got down on our knees and prayed.
Thank you.
Y'all hear what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
What are you doing to make your family happy?
Come on now.
Fussing at them, tell them be happy.
Oh, Jesus.
Why don't y'all smile? How they gonna smile that you acting the devil?
It says, T, shut up.
Whoever I'm talking to, I'm talking to you.
Father.
She told me I lost Periscope. I got about 65 followers, so I'm talking to them too.
You have 100 now.
100?
Yes.
All right, praise God. I'm talking to 100 and whatever's in here. Yes, sir. Your families are God's priority. And the church is God's drama production. So we drama queens, but not the right way. We drama queens fussing and cussing and, well, I don't cuss, but anyway, whatever, you know, talking and fussing. No, you've got to have some love going. And the more you read this, the more love you'll get with it.
Amen, amen.
You know, when people are getting ready to get married, you know how one of the things that get them more in love, they talk to each other. You remember how you get on the phone? I don't know whether y'all did this or not, but we'd be on the phone at nighttime. It'd be 12 o'clock at night almost, and you're still on the phone. Hey, what you doing? Nothing. Oh, Lord. And talk. talking on the phone, trying to talk on the phone, and nothing talk about it, but you're still trying to talk on the phone. And so you can't wait to get together. And then you get together and you fight like cats. But if you keep talking to them and keep talking to the Father, things would work out. They really would. God bless whoever is listening to this. I give you praise, Lord. I thank you for the technology that we have today.
Amen.
Because it does help. We get a lot of feedback from what we're saying, particularly. Oh, dear. We've got to the third scripture, huh? Well, let's do that one, and we'll close with the third one, baby. Ephesians 2.
She said, God bless the 21. Mm-hmm.
Being homes and whole building, being fit together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord.
Go ahead.
You also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit.
The whole temple is built together.
Thank you, Father.
In other words, there's some togetherness here. Because you've been built up in the Lord.
Thank you.
If everybody's reading the same thing, if everybody's on the same page,
mm-hmm.
you understand?
Yes.
Then you're going to be built up together in the Lord. And it's going to be a wonderful thing. I tell you, God's drama production, as we say, is beautiful. The production that he wants to show to the world is beautiful. And it's so beautiful that when people see the beauty of people that are living for Christ, they look at you and they say, well, I would just really like to be like that. I'd like to have that. Isn't that what they say?
Amen.
But if they see you acting like cats and dogs together, they don't want none of that. So it's not going to draw anybody. You can't draw anybody to Christ being anything but loving. You know, even when people, when you're reviled, the scripture says they reviled not again.
Yes.
When Christ reviled not again, when he was reviled, and when he was threatened, he didn't threaten back. You know, he didn't try to give somebody two for their two. He just took it and gave glory to the Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
So we have to learn to let God fight our battles.
Yes.
But we can't fight our battles unless we step back and get in him.
Yeah.
Scripture says, in him we live and move and have our being.
Thank
in
you.
Him.
Yes.
That's the only way you can live is in him. And that's why God called us to holiness. So we could live. He saw how the world was living in turmoil and strife, and he said, I want something better for my kids.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord said, I don't want them living like that. I want them to have love. I want them to have the fruits of the Spirit.
Yes.
Love,
yes.
Joy,
yes.
And peace in the Holy Ghost.
Yes, yes.
But you can't have it in the Holy Ghost unless you get in the Holy Ghost. Say, well, I speak in tongues. That don't mean a thing.
Amen. It sure doesn't.
Unless you're in Christ.
Yes, yes, yes.
You know what? Speaking in tongues only lets you know that God did come in.
Amen.
Once upon a time.
And it edifies you.
But whether he's working in there or not,
it's a different story.
We don't know.
Jesus.
This cup here. It's empty.
Yeah.
But they did have water in it. I just drink it all out. You know what I'm saying? But it's empty. And some of us as vessels, we're so empty. And we need some water. I talked about water a few minutes ago.
Yes.
You need some water. Here it is.
Thank you, Jesus.
Here it is. You say, can't be that easy. It is that easy.
It is that easy.
If drinking water And reading the word can help your kidneys get rid of the toxins. I'm back again on the same thing. Drinking this water will flush out the toxins.
Thank you, Father.
From your body. Amen. But you gotta drink it. There's water right here. See this right here? But it's not in here. It's not gonna do me no good here. Somebody said, I got a Bible, but it's on the shelf. It's by my bedside. And I get sleepy. Wake up. If you get mad, you wake up. Everybody in the house can hear you. Wake up and read the word out loud. Or leave it. And drink it. I'm going to stop after it. Ooh, glory to Jesus. I'm just ready to get the world with another.
We got the words to the song now, Bishop.
Pardon me?